Hello and welcome everyone, all of our viewers on RTL Today, RTL.lu, and of course the FNR website where we're going to stream this entire evening to share with you and to celebrate the achievements of so many researchers, scientists and science communicators from Luxembourg and living, working in Luxembourg. Welcome to the 12th FNR Awards Ceremony. And with me, to join me in our wonderful FNR sitting room this evening, I firstly welcome our host for the evening, Mark. You are the Secretary General of FNR. Mark Schultz, welcome to us this evening. And also representing the government, the Premier Conseiller du Gouvernement, we have Romain Martin. Now, the FNR team have worked extremely hard in these times to maintain as much of the original ceremony as was planned a few months ago, switching plans from normal to hybrid in early September, and then from hybrid to entirely digital in early November to maintain the highest level of safety and security for our awardees and guests. But through this digital medium, we are really, really happy to be able to show you, the viewer, also so much of the scientific work and research that goes on in and around Luxembourg. So we hope you will enjoy sharing this evening with us from the comfort of your own sitting rooms, as much as we will enjoy it here with our own glass of Cremant. If you have a cup of tea, please do raise a toast with us as we celebrate all of the awardees this evening. Firstly, to formally open this evening, Mark, our host for the evening.
Ja, dann ich fange mal Lütze bei Jön. Ich dir alle Guten, die da noch guckt. Ich nicht herzlich willkommen am Namen vom Fonds National der Recherche FNR. Auch ob das für diese Edition, wo man für 12. Kehr Preise, Awards vergehen und verdenkt voll Wissenschaftler und Forscher und auch Science Communicator, Leute, die sich dafür angesetzt haben, für die Wissenschaft die Leute Minute zu bringen. So, a warm welcome to all of you who are listening on and watching this 12th ceremony on behalf of the FNR, where we will celebrate science, where we will celebrate research and researchers and research communicators.
Mark, as Secretary General of FNR, for those who may be watching and don't know what you do, could you explain to us the function, the role of FNR?
Yes, very briefly. So we have several functions, actually, and the main I would say our first and foremost, we are the main funder of research activities here in Luxembourg. So we allocate funding to research, to researchers, for projects, for research programs, and we've been doing this over the past 20 years, I should say, and we have thus been able to contribute significantly to set up what I think should now be the part of the pride of Luxembourg, which is a very competitive and internationally renowned research system here in the country. But of course, we have another mission, and that's very, I would say, is equally important, which is to promote science and also to communicate science to a wider audience. And we are, of course, very active in that area as well. And some of the awards which will be awarded later are also in that field, because we wish to recognize that work.
Do you think people are becoming more interested in science, especially this year when we've had so much science in the news and continues, of course, because COVID, this is why we're here tonight, continues around us?
Well, we've seen over the years, because we do these inquiries, so we have surveys and on representative samples of the population, and we've seen over the years that there is a steadily increasing interest in science, and the population, Luxembourg population, becomes aware that great things are going on and that we're really building up something which is of importance. And you're right, in these troubled times that we are going through, I think more than ever, it has suddenly become, everyone has suddenly become how important in the end science is, and how important also science communication is, because that's another part which has been important to. We're living these times with the pandemic, which was very new, and scientists have made very important contributions, and I hope that would continue like that.
And just thinking about the growth of research within Luxembourg itself, from what I've read and what I've seen and spoken to people about, there's been a burgeoning of growth in the research fields, in the scientific fields in Luxembourg, and in no small part due to the fact that the university now exists.
Yes, well, we have the university, and of course we've also the research centers like the LIST and LICER and the Luxembourg Institute of Health, and all working together with FNR, with the university and with the government. We've set up actually for the first time last year, just at the end of the year, we have defined all together and with the government a strategy for research and innovation for the next years to come. So I think there are going to be many more exciting developments in the next years.
And I think we're going to hear from many of the awardees this evening the very great importance of collaboration in science. We've seen that actually this year as well through COVID, and that's how the vaccine has come to fruition in such a short space of time, everything coming together globally. Romain Martin, Premier Conseiller to the government. In place of Claude Maïch, thank you so much for stepping in at the last minute. Now, as his right-hand man, you will have seen the importance of science in the government's work this year. Can you tell us about that, how science has played a part in political decision-making this year?
Well, I think science had a part it never played before, and it had to take over this role very quickly because the pandemic obviously went from one day to the other. And I'm still impressed, and I think these times had many negative sides, but one positive is really all this engagement that we got from science and this coordinated movement that we got right from the beginning. I think science managed to set up what was called very quickly the Task Force Research Luxembourg, combining all the research institutions, the university, Luxembourg Institute of Health, LIST, LISA, the FNR, several ministerial administrations were also part of it. And we worked all really together in order to see what we can do in order to help to fight this pandemic. And I think a lot of results came out of there, and it's still ongoing. We have now wastewater analysis in order to tell us where we stand with the pandemic. We set up something that is, I think, unique in the world, this large-scale testing, which came out of an idea of science in order to fight the pandemic. We dealt with the socioeconomic consequences, psychological consequences. There were reports made about education, where difficult decisions had to be made. Simulations were made, and I think Mark already mentioned it. One important mission of science is also to explain things to the larger public, and I think also there, all the scientists have been at the forefront in order to provide their expertise to explain things to the public, to replace fear by knowledge, by facts as far as we can have these facts, also to say where we should not have wrong hopes. And I think all this helped a lot in order to go through through these difficult times. And as I said, it's unfortunately not yet over. The task continues, but I think I really want also in the name of the government to thank all these efforts that have been made. I think the government is extremely grateful that that they got all this support, this information, in order to help to take the right decisions to deal with this difficult situation.
I just want to touch on something that Mark mentioned a bit earlier, because I know aside from the COVID situation, you launched a national research and innovation strategy earlier this year. So could you dig into that for us a little bit?
Yes, I think that was also a close collaboration with the FNR, who prepared that for, I think it was more than a year. Then preparatory work was done, and we then together managed to have this set up for December last year, just in time for the launch of the new core projects. And I think it's something that gives the whole, it provides a framework in order to say and to see how we want to develop in the future. It's more mission and oriented, more aligned with the big challenges that the country, but also the world, will face in the upcoming years and decades. And I think it should be a tool, and it will be a tool, to have a more coordinated approach among all the different research stakeholders in Luxembourg, coordinating the efforts of the whole ecosystem. And I think it should help us to put us even better on the international map, shining through our excellence, but also showing the specificities that Luxembourg has and what the world can learn from us. I think a very strong, let's say, asset of Luxembourg is that we can a little bit function like a showcase, what we did, for example, in the pandemic on some specificities that we introduced as a small country in order to how to deal with that, and showing that to the world, communicating that to the world, and I think it will make us stronger in that sense. And I think one first success that I would say that we had is that this year we had for the core program a record number of applications. Now it could also be that people had a little bit more time to write applications because it fell into the time of the pandemics, but I think we also see that many applications were there because the scope was broad enough of what was proposed. And I think another thing that was extremely positive now reviewing what got in for these core proposals is that we got really a good coverage of the whole scope of what we described in the research priority areas. And I think that makes me also very confident that this will be a good framework in order to move forward. And this will be, I think, the awardees of tomorrow, those who got this year the funding in the core project, which I think, Mark, you can confirm was a very high level of quality also, which is also something that should be mentioned here.
Well, we are going to certainly see awards of super high quality this evening. But just on that point also, as you're talking, and of course, science has played such an immense part in the political decision-making landscape across the world this year. Have both sides learned anything? Has a politician learned how to listen to a scientist? And have scientists learned how to speak the language of a politician?
Well, that's an interesting topic, which continues to keep us busy. But I think yes, we have significantly learned from each other. It is an interesting interaction because what scientists should and will continue to provide is expertise. Is what is the current knowledge, and also what is it that we don't know. And in particular with the pandemic, we've heard sometimes that, well, the scientists, there are one who say it's this, others say the contrary. Well, we have to be aware that 6 months ago, almost nothing was known of this virus, of this pandemic. And 6 months in research is a very, very short time. It's very small on the time scale of research. So we are constantly discovering new things. And I think that's whereas politicians have to take decisions, decisions with incomplete data, which is something which is, I think they do a great job, but something very difficult. But we have to see, scientists have to see how these data can be completed, how we can get a better picture. I think we've certainly in Luxembourg the interaction was very very positive. We've learned from each other. We've learned how scientists have learned how politicians think and reflect. I think politicians have also learned what science can and what it cannot, and that there are time scales which are maybe different.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think both sides learned a lot also on the way how to communicate with each other, and I think this is also something that will continue. I think we all know that this pandemic has accelerated a number of things that were in the making already. You know, digitalization went a strong step further. We here are functioning now in a completely different way, and many of these things will remain or have been accelerated, trends that were already there before. And I think also problems that have been a little bit less in the news, like climate change, will come again, will become again extremely important also at the exit of this pandemic. And for all these, we need innovation, we need research, we need new knowledge, and we need then a constant exchange and communication between political stakeholders who have to take decisions in complex environments and science who can provide empirical knowledge that will help to take these decisions. So I think one lasting effect of this pandemic, and a positive one, is that we learned a lot about this communication and how to take into account evidence and empirical data in decision making.
Well, you mentioned things have gone digital. We were meant to be surrounded by the presence of the awardees this evening. As it turns out, we're here in this lovely sitting room, FNR sitting room here. We should have had many more little pockets of sitting rooms around us, but just to reveal to you where we are actually, we are in a wonderfully large, expansive space here, all alone, just the three of us, and a fantastic team behind the scenes. But this is where you all should have been, but we're really trying to keep the essence of the day together, to celebrate together from your own homes, the comfort of your living rooms. But here is the room that we wanted to share with you in person, even in a hybrid setting, but now fully digital, as you said, Romain, and that will continue no doubt for some time. So welcome to our little sitting room here in this beautiful room here within the University of Luxembourg in the Maison des Arts et des Etudiants. Now, just a little word about the award itself. You can see it next to me here, and this represents a combination of things in Luxembourg. It's made out of steel. It's 3D steel printing. Steel, of course, to represent the wealth of Luxembourg in the 20th century, moving now towards knowledge of the 21st century. And you can see the logo of the FNR itself there on the base of this wonderful award for all of the winners this evening. To mention also, we do have the shortlist for every section on the FNR website. So do go there to see the shortlist of all of the amazing projects, science communication, science research, which you will see on the FNR website itself. But moving swiftly on to our first category. The first award category has two winners. It's for Outstanding PhD Thesis. And our first winner is Thierry Chekam, working with the University of Luxembourg and SNT for his PhD thesis to improve the quality control of software testing. The actual title of his thesis is Assessment and Improvement of the Practical Use of Mutation for Automated Software Testing. So it's computational science. Stay with me, stay with me. We're going to learn more in a video shortly. But basically, we're surrounded by the essence of software and it needs to work for us. Otherwise, there could be huge economic losses. It can also affect our health and the safety of so many networks. So it's critical that the basis of the software works. Thierry tested the most widely used checks, which are called statement coverage criterion, and he compared that to mutation method. And he went to go on to design a machine learning technique that can improve the quality control of one of these methods, I won't give away which one, by 20 to 30%. And his tool are now available on the open source data portal. The judges selected this thesis because it was impressive academic curriculum with tight integration in several cultures. He had an exceptional publication record, and the results can be adapted and applied in related domains. Some of them are now explored in current industrial projects. So let's find out more in this short video.
I am Thierry Chekam. I am a postdoctoral researcher at SNT, which is the Interdisciplinary Center for Security, Reliability and Trust of the University of Luxembourg. I am honored to receive the FNR Outstanding PhD Thesis Award for my research on quality control of software testing. If software fails, there can be dramatic consequences. There can be economic losses. And in the worst case, this can affect our health or even our safety. Therefore, software needs to be tested before release. However, there are cases where some faults are still present in the software when they are released. And this happened because the tests are not good enough. That's why in my PhD thesis, I developed techniques in order to improve the quality control of software testing. Software is usually tested by executing with a given input and checking whether it behaves as expected. This means that it runs well and produces the right results. A simple example is a calculator. If you give it as input 7 plus 5 and you get 2 as a result, that is wrong because 7 plus 5 equals to 12. Then what you do in that case is that you have to go through the code and find where the problem is and fix it. There are several methods. The most widely used is statement coverage criterion. It checks the quality of test by measuring the number of comments that are executed by the test. The intuition is that you're more likely to find errors in comments that have not been executed by the test. However, this criterion checks that the comments are executed, but it doesn't check that they are executed correctly. Another method is called mutation. It creates artificial errors in the program, called mutations, and then check whether the test can find those artificial errors. The more errors the test finds, the better it is. It was unclear which method is more effective for testing software. And we found in our research that mutation is more effective than the widely used statement coverage at finding errors in software. However, mutation testing is very expensive and software developers find it tedious to write tests that are good with regard to mutation testing. We address this in two ways. First, by designing a machine learning techniques that selects the most useful mutants that can find bugs better than the state of the art. Secondly, we design an automated test generation technique that generate additional tests to the existing tests in order to detect the mutants that were not previously detected by the existing test. The results of my PhD are published and the tools are available open source and my research is currently used in a project paper. Currently, I am extending the work of my PhD to software that are updated so that we don't need to execute all the tests with the new versions of the software.
Thierry, congratulations. Fantastic award, fantastic achievement. I'm sure you must have some thank yous that you'd like to say.
Yes, sure. Thank you very much. I would like to thank the FNR first for this award and also for providing me funding to do my PhD research. I would also like to thank the University of Luxembourg for providing a good environment to perform the research. My PhD thesis is not solely the result of my personal effort. There are many persons that have contributed to that. And some have contributed more directly to my research. I would like to name my two supervisors, Professor Yves Le Trau and Dr. Mike Papadakis for their good advice and support. I would also like to thank my research collaborators and my PhD thesis evaluation committee, and also my colleagues from the CERVAL team at SNT. And some other people contributed in a more personal way, and I would like to thank my wife for her support and patience. I would also like to thank my parents, Mr. Chekam Maurice and Mrs. Chekam Clarice for their sacrifices to enable me to have good education and for the encouragement. I would like to thank also my siblings and my whole extended family. And I would also like to thank all the educators that taught me during my pre-PhD studies. And finally, and most importantly, I would like to thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who saved me and gave me the ability to have good health, to be able to perform the research, to be able to have the joy and and be able to do the research stress-free. And one of the passages that encouraged me and kept me going, sometimes when it was a bit difficult, was a passage from the Bible that says that whatever you do, work at it as if you work for God and not for living people. Thank you.
Thierry, that's a very soulful thank you speech. I think it's dumbfounded us all. Thank you for your incredible work. You are a very humble person. We had a little chat yesterday, and just at the end of our chat, I discovered that moving from Cameroon, please tell our viewers, where did you choose to do your undergraduate studies?
Well, I did my undergraduate studies in China.
And why? Why China? How come you moved from Africa to China?
Well, there was a program, a cooperation scholarship program between Cameroon and China, and it's quite selective. So I applied to the program after I finished my high school diploma, and I wanted to do study abroad because it's supposed to be better than in Cameroon. And I can learn more things. So I was selected by the grace of God to go to China, and I started my studies.
And not just that, but you arrived in China not speaking Chinese.
Yeah.
So you also learned Chinese as you were off to do your undergraduate studies there. And then when it came to the PhD, I believe you had a few choices there also.
Yes. After my master's degree in China, I applied for a PhD in several universities, and I was shortlisted by the University of Luxembourg and the University of Melbourne in Australia.
So and, Australia or Luxembourg? So why did Luxembourg win you?
Well, it's more personal. What happened is that I was a bit in the middle for what I choose. I did not know so much about Luxembourg, to be honest. I knew more about Australia. But I was like, I don't know which one to choose. So I was like, since I'm a Christian, let me pray to God and ask him what he wants me to do. And I asked for a sign, and the sign came for Luxembourg. Therefore, I came to Luxembourg. And I'm very glad that I came to Luxembourg because it's been a great country. I really enjoy Luxembourg.
And just turning to your research now, what's the future for you? Where are you going to take your work?
Well, currently I am doing a postdoc to extend the research that I've been doing during my PhD. And after that, I'm planning to either move in industry or continue with the research, maybe in another university. But I think it's more likely that I will end up in an industry to actually put that into practice.
Well, Thierry, from all of us here, a fantastic award to win, and hopefully winning this prize for your outstanding thesis will serve you well in life, and you'll go on to do many more amazing things in whatever country you end up in beyond Luxembourg. But we want to hold on to you for a while longer yet.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations, and enjoy the evening ahead.
Congratulations.
Now, moving on to our second winner for the same category, actually. So we have another FNR winner for outstanding PhD thesis, and this goes to Maciej Chrzanowski. Now, we spent a while trying to teach me how to pronounce his name yesterday. He's Polish, and he's done his PhD between the University of Luxembourg and ArcelorMittal. His PhD thesis was based on composite columns used in the construction of tall buildings, entitled Shear Transfer in Heavy Steel Concrete Composite Columns with Multiple Encased Steel Profiles. So his thesis analyzed the structural behavior of a particular type of heavy composite column that forms the backbone of our modern high-rise buildings. And he also proposed an innovative engineering model and a new type of shear connector that can help to improve the safety and cost efficiency of tall building constructions. So reasons why the jury selected you, Matthew, is, for example, one of the strongest points that emerges whilst reading this thesis is the consistency in the design of the experimental activity. The PhD project has been developed in a significantly international scientific environment characterized by collaborations with several researchers active in Europe in the subject of the thesis, and the collaboration with the R&D department of one of the most important steelmakers, which will certainly magnify the impact of this research and offer a fast track to the field application. So let's take a look at your work, Maciej.
My name is Maciej Chrzanowski. I am a construction engineer at ArcelorMittal Stelligence, and I have done my PhD at the University of Luxembourg in collaboration with ArcelorMittal. I am happy to receive an FNR Award for Outstanding PhD Thesis for my research on a composite column with multiple encased steel profiles used to construct tall buildings. In our modern world, population numbers keep growing and the space to construct a new building stays stable. This pushes our cities to grow vertically and construct taller buildings where we could live and work in. When engineering tall buildings, it's important to consider the safety aspect using columns that can support the weight of the construction and act as the backbone of the entire building. But also it's important to consider sustainability to guarantee the optimal use of building materials. However, in past years, the use of regular columns in civil engineering for tall buildings did not really evolve. This led to the limitation on the size of the building or use big section elements which risk wasting important construction materials. My research provides a way to properly assess the structural behavior of novel but less studied heavy composite columns with multiple encased steel profiles. In our labs, we construct a smaller specimen of columns that were constructed just in the way like bigger columns used in tall buildings, which was already a challenge. To see which complex composition and connection in steel and concrete was the best in terms of force transfer and stability, we pressed these specimens with the hydraulic press while the specimens were connected to different types of sensors. These smaller columns were used to study the locally acting shear forces, meaning movement between steel and concrete within the column. With this, we want to analyze the mechanical connectors between both materials. In the second phase, we move to the analysis of the global transfer of forces, which is visible, for example, when we bend the larger entire column. Imagine this bend is such a column. Inside a tall building, among all acting forces, it is mainly compressed under the weight of the entire building. It could buckle and bend, and this is normally considered deformation shape. In my research, we observe that a new deformation shape could lead to certain circumstances which could cause earlier damage of the building, which is also an aspect of a safety. There exist several models that can predict how a column could bend under pressure. However, the most used theory does not consider shear forces, or other theories do not refer properly to the behavior of the tested columns. Therefore, I propose a new innovative engineering model in my thesis, which can assess properly the structural behavior of columns in tall buildings, which can therefore guarantee the stability and sustainability of the entire building. What's more, my model can be easily implemented into the existing simplified design procedure. Additionally, I develop and characterize a new product that can be used in those heavy columns, but also in the regular ones. This novel shear connector can make the whole construction process faster and safer, but also reduce the cost and manpower needed. My results and novel product are very promising and are currently being developed further. I am very happy to have collaborated with the local industry in Luxembourg for my PhD and that my research actively contributes to make the buildings of tomorrow safer and more sustainable.
Maciej, lovely to have you with us this evening and congratulations on this award. Tell us who the lovely lady is next to you, who supported you through all of this work.
Exactly. All the time. This is my wife, my daughter.
Lovely, lovely to have you with him this evening. Maciej, your work. I was discussing with you yesterday that you almost didn't apply for this award.
Exactly. I would say the road trip that I passed was quite surprising, I would say. At the beginning, as you mentioned, Lisa, I haven't thought that I was doing PhD at all. And maybe at this time I could start to saying thank you to all the people who appears on my roadmap. So I really need to start with my former supervisor, Violeta Barcevich, who really suggests me this road and pushed me a bit towards this. And then I take the opportunity and seem to try, and it worked. So it was really a big turnover in my life. Our life. And on the second point, yes, after this decision, I moved to Luxembourg. I joined the research team of Professor Christoph Odenbright. And this is for sure the second person I would really like to say big thank you for the entire support and giving me this chance to do PhD at all. And staying in the topic of the university, for sure I need to mention the entire team that was there around, the team of Professor Odenbright. I would say this, the input of each person was very, very, very important. As it was also mentioned in the first words from you, my PhD was in collaboration with ArcelorMittal, and there I got also very huge support from everybody, especially from the R&D department, where I really need to thank for the entire support to Renata Obiala and Teodora Bogdan, but also to Professor Olivier Vassard and Nicoleta Popa. I would say I had this pleasure to join even the team of R&D for some time, as it was foreseen in the FNR funding. And I must say this time was really, really inspiring. Let's call it like this. Saying about FNR funding, I would say this is also quite a big milestone in my research, because without this, or maybe in other words, thanks to this, my research was really structured and we followed the plan, and there was no distractions that maybe we should stay here or go there. No, we had a really clear plan how to proceed, which I am really grateful for the entire support and structurizing my work somehow.
Well, you're very lucky. We've got the head of FNR watching you, your exactly. Every word here. And actually,
no, it's really helpful.
His background is physics. And we were having a little chat about another thing you mentioned to me in our conversation, Maciej, which is that you never thought civil engineering could win an award. And we were smiling about this, Mark. Have you any words of support?
Well, we're very open-minded in that
yes,
sense.
Indeed. Yes, indeed. So you're now the new role model for all civil engineers.
Exactly. For me, it's like double win, because to be honest, I'm too skeptic at the beginning, but I was really not believing that civil engineering topic could really pass through all more spectacular topics like physics or medicine, or everything now is around COVID and all this very important stuff like this. And come on, buildings are just standing. Yeah, but
well, I have
if we look really behind the scenes, it's very complex process that
I have one last quick question for you. Mm-hmm. Given your research, are there certain buildings that you look at in certain countries that you would not step inside?
Ooh.
Because of safety.
I would say there should be no problem like this for our modern buildings, because we have quite well defined our design procedures, how we should safely design a building. The other point that we have to look on is sustainability. And sometimes when we do not understand something very well, we just go more conservative and just build it more safe or something like this. But here arises a question about optimal use of the material, which is, I would say, quite significant topic nowadays.
Maciej Chrzanowski, congratulations once more from all of us.
We
wish you both a very wonderful evening ahead. Enjoy the rest of the night. Moving on to our next category. It's the FNR Award for Outstanding Research-Driven Innovation, for which there is only one winner. And representing this award, I'm joined by the winner, Claudine Kirsch, who won it with her PhD collaborator, Simone Mortini, from the University of Luxembourg. Claudine won this for developing a series of educational videos on how multiple language learning practices can be used in daycare and nurseries in a pedagogical setting. Luxembourg, as we all know, has a huge linguistic and cultural diversity, which can be quite overwhelming to start teaching young children. So their videos have shown professionals how children from all nationalities can feel included. They are currently the only evidence-based videos that exist to show practical examples of multilingual pedagogy, activities and strategies for both the formal and non-formal education sector. And they're available right now to be used at the University of Luxembourg and the Service National de la Jeunesse. So let's take a look at Claudine's work.
Mein Name ist Claudine Kirsch, alles hier in Sprachforscherin, auch Professor auf der Uni Lützburg. Und der Fokus von meiner Arbeit, die Leute lehren und muss ein Lehrer für Sprachen, das hauptsächlich bei kleinen Kindern, die durch mehr Sprachen dazu gehen. Zusammen mit Simone Mortini, meiner ehemaligen Doktorandin, du kriegst vom FNR den Award für Outstanding Research-Driven Innovation. Und das für eine Serie Videos, die Edukatoren und Enseignern helfen, eine mehrsprachige Pädagogik im Alltag umzusetzen. Die Education für Rilang an Griechen und am CEN, also an den Spielschulen, das ist ein ganz wichtiges Programm heute zu Lützburg, weil den dreht zu der Inklusion von allen Kindern bei. Und zwar, weil in Hölf, dass alle Kinder ihre Ressourcen, also die sprachlich und die kulturell, wertgeschätzt werden. Also die Kinder waren auch Enseignanten und Indikatoren, die ein bisschen unsicher sind, wie sie mit dieser Sprachendiversität sollen umgehen und wie sie auch die Ressourcen von den Kindern können aufbauen. Und dafür haben wir 8 Online-Videos produziert im Kader von unserem Projekt Moonipack. Und die weisen da ganz konkrete Beispiele, wie ihr so eine mehrsprachige Pädagogik entwickeln und ersetzen. Für das Video haben wir ganz eng mit 7 Enseignern und Edukatoren während einem ganzen Jahr zusammen geschafft. Am Anfang hat man eine Formation continue und da sind sich verschiedene dann aber ihre monolingualen Ideologien bewusst gehen und sie haben dann noch etwas zu Mehrsprachigkeit erweitert. Und dann haben sie eine ganze Serie von Aktivitäten, auf Routinen, auf verschiedene Sprachen ausprobiert und developiert. Weil an die gehen dann nur an diese Video halt demonstriert und erklärt. Wir sind eine Gruppe von Kindern, die mit der Edukatrice an der Griech dann nur eine Geschichte lauschen, die die Eltern daheim auf der App ITO abgeholt haben.
Für was muss ich immer einen Bank holen, weil ich nicht mitziehen und abstürmen, weil ich mitziehen?
Dann lauschen sie Lieder, die die Eltern an der Familie sprachen, also Russisch, Französisch, Italienisch, abgeholt haben.
Was soll man machen? Ich sehe Papa!
Sie sehen Papa? Papa singt?
Schön!
Ich meine, gesagt, ich habe wirklich die Freude und Begeisterung von den Kindern. Vielleicht doch, weil mir wirklich die Kinder, den Eltern und den Edukatoren eine Stimme geben. Weil die Videos, die in der Formation kontinuieren, vom Service National de la Jeunesse von der Uni Lützburg benutzt, aber auch bei uns an Bachelorpuren, und dafür habe ich zum Beispiel schon mit 800 Studenten an Edukatoren und Enseignern geguckt und diskutiert. Die Videos die findet ihr dann auf der Webseite, sowohl von SNJ wie dann auch von Lützburg. Sie sind in Lützburg, aber es sind auch viele von denen, die haben Französisch zu titeln und nur noch extra auf Englisch zu titeln. Die Leute fanden das Video ganz hilfreich, weil sie über ganz konkrete Antworten gehen auf die ganze Problematik. Also ich weiß noch, ganz konkrete Praxisbeispiele, die zu Lützburg stabilisiert gesehen und die dürfen natürlich auch im mehrsprachigen Kontext passen. Das sind doch momentan die einzigen evidence-based Videos, die es gut für so eine mehrsprachige Pädagogik, Aktivitäten und Strategien zu weisen, dass sowohl im nonformellen wie im formellen Sektor, also sie weisen eben, wie sie erklären sollen.
Claudine, massive congratulations on this outstanding award for your research-driven innovation. Now, I just wanted to read to you a couple of the comments from the jury. This is the type of project in humanities and social sciences that will significantly enhance Luxembourg's reputation worldwide. And they were really impressed by the effort and skill taken to create these teaching materials. It shows real passion to make societal impact. So congratulations. I'm sure you have some thank yous that you would also like to say to us.
Yeah, well, thank you. I mean, first of all, I'm, of course, very delighted to get this award for outstanding research innovation. And yes, there are a lot of people I'd like to thank, people and institutions, starting with the FNR and the Minister of Education. So, also, vielmals merci, Herr Schilz, vielmals merci, Herr Maisch, für die generöse Unterstützung. And then second, of course, my team. So there is Gabriela Alexvich, Simon Martini, Laurence de Letizia, and Katja Andersen. And I would really like to thank them for their enthusiasm, their professionalism, and their hard work. Yeah, the idea of working on multilingual pedagogies comes from Ophelia Garcia from New York and our expert Yuli Panagiotopoulou from the University of Cologne. So both were our experts. They supported, they guided, and they really helped. So thank you, Ophelia. Vielen Dank, Yuli. Yeah, then we had a big team, so I'd like to congratulate, because it's their movies as well, Paul Linden and Marc Mergen from DEPAF, from the ministry, who filmed for us, and then Most, who put the movies together. So thank you very much for your patience and the work. And then, of course, the key players, the teachers, the educators, the children, and the parents who we were able to observe a whole year in the schools and in the nurseries. And in the end, we filmed them. So thank you for your time and your generosity. Yes, the last people would actually be my husband and my children, because I spent a lot of time editing the videos in the summer of 2017, and they were really understanding and very patient.
Yes, I'm sure they're all very proud of you, Claudine. And just thinking about a conversation we had before this evening's awards ceremony, we were talking about not just the very hard work that's involved in science, but also the element of luck that can play a part. And you happened to just ride the wave at the perfect time when it came to the law, or perhaps you maybe instigated that wave to gain momentum, because you wrote the grant proposal for this in 2015, I believe. And then we had the change in law in 2017. Is that correct?
Yes, that's
and
correct.
And Roman here might know a little bit more about that.
Ja, ich wollte schon mal ganz herzlich felicitieren, Claudine. Das war ja eine super Gelegenheit, für sich auch an Covid-Zeiten herumzugehen. Ich meine, die Leschke, wo wir zusammen sitzen, haben wir an einem Komitee zusammen gesprochen über Multilinguismus bei kleinen Kindern. Und du weißt einfach, wie ihr es gemerkt habt. Also ein super Projekt. Und denke, ganz herzlich Felicitationen noch von meiner Seite.
Vielen merci. Yeah, I mean, I've been working in education my whole life, I can say, and I wrote the project in 2015 because I really tried to develop inclusive pedagogies. And so we started in 2016, and in 2016, Minister Maisch had brought out the Education Plurilingue, and so it was really nice in parallel. So it was really you know, luck. And so I think that made the project so meaningful for us. And that's why we worked really hard, because we could sense that we could make a real contribution, a real societal contribution. And yes, I think the movies are being used now by the Service National de la Jeunesse, by the university, and I really hope that they continue to inspire teachers, educators, and our students.
Massive congratulations to you and your team. And I know that all of the joy that we've seen in the video of the little children to see their languages being shown in the primary schools, or of course before that in the nurseries and the précoce, you can see the joy in their faces as they hear their mother tongue at home. Massive congratulations, and we know that your videos will continue to be used, and I know from our earlier conversation that you're going to build on this momentum, not just with the educators, but you'll probably branch out to touch upon our home lives as parents as well.
Yes, I am. We're currently doing the project Compare, which is collaboration with parents and multiliteracies. So we continue to work in early childhood education, and we have already produced the first two films because of the success of the other ones. But at the same time, I'm leading the project COVID Kids. So we have the first results out there, which is really nice as well, because it enabled us to work with the WHO as well. And so here we are looking at the well-being of the children and their homeschooling experiences, which was quite an important project as well.
Enjoy the rest of the evening, enjoy your award, and many congratulations once more to you and your whole team, and best of luck with the continued research.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Now, moving on to our next category, it's the FNR Award for... Outstanding Scientific Publication. Our first winners for this category are Carole Linster and her team. The title of their publication is a little tricky to say, so I'm just going to say the second half of it. A novel neurodegenerative disorder exacerbated by febrile illnesses. And the reason the jury selected this publication for an award was many reasons, a few of them. Overall, the work presented in this publication is a tour de force. Technically, the work presented is excellent and will have tangible benefits to patients and their families. Beyond the direct impact of human health, this work highlights the importance of metabolite repair systems in cellular biology and human health. This is a concept which has only emerged recently and has been led by the applicants of this award. So let's take a look at their work.
Ich bin Carole Linster. Ich lebe in der Enzymologie am Metabolismusgruppe am LCSB, dem Luxembourg Center for Systems Biomedicine, auf der Uni Lützburg. Ich bin ganz stolz, den FNR Award for Outstanding Scientific Publications zu kriegen. Zusammen mit Partnern aus Amerika, Australien und England haben wir eine selten unbekannte Kinderkrankheit beschrieben, aber wissen, dass das eine genetische Ursache hat. Ma 2017 kriegt man eine E-Mail aus Australien. An dieser E-Mail haben uns drei renommierte Forschungsgruppen aus allen Ecken von der Welt gefragt, ob wir uns hier Proben von Patienten mal können Mino gucken. Hier Patienten waren eine Handvoll kleine Kinder. Sie hatten ein rares Krankheitsbild ohne bekannten Ursprung. Sie hatten alle neurologische Symptome, die von einem meistens von einem banalen Fieber provoziert gesehen. Leider sind alte Kinder mehr oder weniger kurzfristig an dieser Krankheit gestorben. Die Forscher hatte schon herausgefunden, dass alte Kinder Mutationen an einem gewissen Gen haben. Die Gen mit dem Namen NaxD hatte ich 2011 identifiziert. Und seitdem habe ich mit meiner Equipe viel darüber geschafft und darüber publiziert. Und so sind sie angefangen, auf uns aufmerksam zu gehen. An der Publikation weisen wir, dass Mutationen an dem NaxD-Gen tatsächlich die Ursache von der Krankheit ist, auf jeden Fall. An unserem Körper spielen sich im Moment tausende von chemischen Reaktionen auf, die sind lebenswichtig. Mit beiden Reaktionen entstehen aber auch viele Abfallprodukte. Die Abfallprodukte die können giftig gehen für unsere Zellen, wenn sie sich aussammeln. Der NaxD-Gen den encodiert ein Enzym, das an unserem Körper dafür zuständig ist, die giftig Abfallprodukte aufzubauen. Ein einfacher Vergleich. An einem Restaurant entstehen all der viele Auffallprodukte, die nicht weitergebracht gehen. Wenn aber nicht regelmäßig ein Drecksauto geflankt kommt, für das Auffallprodukte wegzufeiern oder zu recyceln, dann hat der Restaurant schnell ein sanitäres Problem. Bei den Kindern mit dieser Krankheit funktioniert der sanitäre Mechanismus nicht mehr, wenn es den Mutationen am nächsten Ege. Obwohl die Forschung viele neue Resultate bringt, können noch viele von den raren Krankheiten, bei denen nicht gewusst ist, was die Ursache ist, wie sie sich entwickelt oder wie sie kann behandeln. Schon lange vor dieser Publikation haben wir an unserer Equipe und diesen sanitären Schutzmechanismen geforscht. Wir als Biochemiker hatten also das Wissen und Methoden, für so eine genetische Krankheit herumzugehen. Und als medizinische Partner haben Patienten gefunden mit genau so einer raren Krankheit. Eine perfekte Kooperation also. Wir konnten zum Beispiel nachweisen, dass das Aufbauen von den gefährlichen Nervenprodukten nicht ganz gut funktioniert, wenn wir Mutationen am nächsten Enzym rückgängig gemacht haben. Tatsächlich sind es schon echt Therapieansätze gegeben. Basierend auf diesen Resultaten sind zwei Patienten mit einer Vitamin B behandelt gegeben. Diesen harmlosen Treatment hat wirklich drastisch positive Effekte auf ihre neurologischen Symptome und auch ihre schlimmen Hautprobleme. Das vielversprechende Resultat lassen uns natürlich hoffen, dass wir in Zukunft viele andere von diesen seltenen Krankheiten auch können besser verstehen können, für dann sie besser zu behandeln und vielleicht auch heilen zu können.
Carole Linster, incredibly moving video there, telling us about your work and why you have won this award for an outstanding scientific publication. Firstly, talk to us about the team.
Yes, I mean, they are the first ones that I would like to thank also, because a work like this is only possible with a team. And so they were the members of my research group from Luxembourg, Julia Becker-Catan, Nicole Paxia, Jean-François Conrot, and Daniel Kay. This award is for you as well. So I'm really sorry that you cannot be here with me tonight, but thank you for the excellent work that you contributed to this research. Then it's not only Luxembourg. So in this rare disease research, we have to, you know, we have to collaborate around the world. And this was really a fantastic collaboration with medical doctors, clinical researchers, fundamental researchers from Australia, the US, the UK, Spain, Germany, India, and Luxembourg. So yes, I would like to thank all of them. And well, it was a multinational team, and together, putting our expertises together, we were able to get to the cause of this disease.
And will eventually save lives. Now, Mark, when it comes to funding projects like this, from both of your perspectives, how easy is it, Carole, to get funding for rare disease research?
So no, it's indeed not very easy at all. So I would like to say that we start often from a very fundamental research. And really, I would like to give a special thanks to the FNR, because they are supporting my work since several years now. And I think from a time where there was absolutely no connection to disease yet. So I think nobody expected necessarily at the beginning that afterwards there would be the discovery of a new of the cause of a new disease. And I would really like to thank them for support, for putting the trust in us, and for supporting fundamental research. And then in the end, also our rare disease research, which is unfortunately often neglected by private industry, but even by official research funding agencies,
is not always a priority area, I would say.
And so, Mark, from your point of view, how is it when you come upon grants like this and proposals? How do you know when to say yes?
Well, I think this is a very moving story because it was what Carole did in the is fundamental research, and it also illustrates yes that we need also to continue and support fundamental research because she did the work on these enzymes without actually knowing that this was this turned out to be responsible for a rare children disease. And then this other team in Australia, medical doctors were puzzled about a disease which they saw, and then the connection happened across continents through this email, is my understanding. So it's a very interesting, it's a very nice story. It shows how science works sometimes.
It also shows the global nature of science,
absolutely,
and the global cooperation.
Absolutely.
So, Carole, fantastic story. We wish you the very best of luck in your continued research in something that actually touches a lot of people's lives. Again, yesterday you said to me on a phone call that rare disease actually affects about 7% of families in Europe.
Exactly. So one has to say a rare disease is defined if less than one person in 2,000 is suffering from such a disease, it's a rare disease. But there are several thousand, actually more than 7,000 different rare diseases. So in the end, this adds up to something around 5% to 7% of the population. So in Luxembourg, it is estimated that around 30,000 people suffer from the one or the other rare disease. So globally, it is actually a big problem for the society that has to be tackled by international collaborations like ours, for example. And I would like to say also, I mean, concerning the support for this, I would like to thank really also a lot of private donors and foundations that over these years now have supported in addition this kind of research.
Carole, to you and your team, the highest congratulations from us all. Very best of luck. We can't wait to see what you produce in the future, but we know that research is not a fast-moving game.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
And now moving to the second award in this group for outstanding scientific publication. It goes to Laurent Pfister and his team from LIST, the Luxembourg Institute of Science and Technology, for their work on fundamental hydrological processes that control the movement of water a little bit deeper below the Earth's surface. The title of this outstanding publication is Bedrock Geology Controls on Catchment Storage, Mixing and Release, comparative analysis of 16 nested catchments. But the video will tell us more about that. So he's tracked the age of water, the movement of water, and this over a long period of time. And again, it was a global collaboration. Now, the reasons the jury selected this publication for award, the central advancement here is the ability to weave together numerous approaches into a simple and unifying theory. The work synthesizes and brings together what are seen as conflicting views. This interconnected group of senior and junior researchers is exemplar of how to maintain generational success in the physical sciences in today's globalized culture. It's not surprising that this team of authors with experience spanning generations were able to weave together such a compelling story. So let's take a look at Laurent and his team's work.
My name is Laurent Pfister. I'm the head of the Catchment and Eco-Hydrology Research Group at the Luxembourg Institute of Science and Technology. Together with our colleagues from Canada and New Zealand, we received the FNR Award for Outstanding Scientific Publications for our work in the Alzette River Basin, where we have worked on fundamental hydrological functions of water collection, storage and release, and how they are actually controlled by bedrock geology. For decades, we have been investigating how rainfall is transformed into flow in our rivers. And most of our understanding of these mechanisms stems from our investigations that have been carried out either at the surface or at best a few centimeters below the surface. We've carried out pioneering work in 16 nested catchments of the Alzette River Basin, where we have investigated how bedrock geology, spanning in some areas down to 80 meters deep,
actually controls how runoff is generated, how the flow in the rivers is generated, and also how old the water is. For determining the age of water, we actually use the chemical signature of rainfall and stream water, because these signatures change over time, and they also change in space. And it's these two informations that we use for determining where the water flows and how long it stays in a catchment.
We found that catchments with more impermeable bedrock usually have a much lower storage capacity, which means that the water travels or rainfall travels through them faster, showing that the water is younger in those systems. But this also means that they are much less resilient during dry period, during droughts. In general, it's important to understand how our water reservoirs develop, how climate change is impacting them, and what's the relevance for our drinking water supply. Until now, we lack the data sets to study and understand how underlying geologies control hydrological processes. The Alzette River Basin is a perfect study site for that, with 16 different catchments. They have different geologies, different sizes, but a uniform climate. We had a 9-year data set of hydrometeorological observations. We had observations in streamflow and precipitation across all these sites. This is a unique and outstanding data set on global scale. For the research community, we provide a template how to study hydrological processes, which is now applied in the Alps and in Canada. For Luxembourg, we provide necessary information for stakeholders in the water sector on how to manage water resources under change.
Laurent, thank you for joining us. A massive congratulations to you and your team. Welcome to your son and your wife there next to you. It's lovely to have you all with us this evening. Hello to you. Hello. What's your name?
Castello. Sudano.
Lasso.
Welcome to our evening. You must be very, very proud of your daddy and his team. Laurent, congratulations. Do tell us about the team that you worked with on this publication.
Yeah, so, well, as you already have seen in the little movie, so it is a very mixed team. So we have colleagues from our group, Nuria Martinez-Carreras, Christoph Fisler, Julian Klaus, then also Gwenaël Carrère, who has in the meantime left us for France, and then a colleague from New Zealand, Mike Stewart, and Jeff McDonald from the University of Saskatchewan in Canada. So I really would like to thank them, because they, without them, this work wouldn't have been possible. And I think what is really unfortunate is that we can't celebrate this together. And so I really am proud of them, and I hope they know it. At least here I have the opportunity to let them know that. And also, there have been really a big bunch of people that have been involved in the project. Let's say in because this is actually the outcome of several projects that have spanned over like a decade and even a little bit more. So working somewhat in the back, going to the fields, taking the water samples, doing the analysis in the lab. And there my thanks really also go to François Barniche, who was really a very strong workforce in that respect. And I think such a long-standing effort wouldn't have been possible without the support that we got on this very long period from our institute, the now known as the Luxembourg Institute of Science and Technology. But this has really spanned like almost two decades. And also I am extremely thankful towards the FNR, because they, I mean, I should say you actually, the FNR has been with us for like 20 years also, repeatedly helping us to carry out this, what could at the beginning look like very fundamental work, but which actually has very applied outcomes in the end. So a big, big thank you for that. And of course, I would like to thank my family, my lovely wife, my wonderful son. I mean, being active in research also means working for very long hours and being away quite often, and without their support, it wouldn't be possible actually to carry out that kind of project.
Well, it's lovely it's lovely to see them with you. And I suppose one small upside of us not having you here in person tonight is that you can celebrate this evening in your home with your family. So congratulations to you and your team. And you touched on a couple of really important things there. You touched on the long time scale here for your type of research and the absolute need of institutions, foundations, such as the FNR, to provide you with the funding for that, and also the absolute connectivity, the global connectivity. You mentioned your time in New Zealand, in Canada. So, Mark, again, I'm turning to you. When you have researchers coming to you with this project ongoing for decades, how do you think about sponsoring it?
Well, much of this is related to quality, and that's why we do quite strict quality assessments. But we do that with the help of international experts, other researchers actually, so who know actually and who can assess, well, is this research, even though it is long. Long-term research, which in the end can produce useful results, which clearly was the case here. And congratulations, Laurent, for this efforts, which you say, which has been going on almost for two decades. And it may sound, sometimes we need the data. So these were data that were collected over 9 years, but it now turns out to be the most precious data set on that topic, which is available to researchers worldwide. So which is attracts interest worldwide as well, and the subject itself, if we think about the changing climate and what may happen in the future, I think it's extraordinarily precious. I think both of the projects that we just saw underline that, yes, there isn't a division between fundamental research on the other hand, on one hand, and applications on the other. It's really flowing, and we try to take into account that.
Absolutely. And just to echo that, one reviewer said about the Catchment Eco-Hydrology Group at List, and I quote, "It's one of the most important research groups in hydrology in Europe and in the world." And undoubtedly, this publication just echoes that sentiment. So a huge congratulations to you, and the backdrop perhaps to the COVID situation we find ourselves in now, something that will affect all of our lives, is climate change. And no doubt your work will help to understand the movement of water and various other factors within that backdrop to everybody's life right now. Thank you, Laurent, and congratulations to you and your team. Enjoy the rest of tonight.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Now, moving on to our final category, we have the FNR Award for Outstanding Promotion of Science to the Public. Our first winner for this category is Carole Blond-Hanten from LISER, the Luxembourg Institute of Socioeconomic Research. She designed the game GG, Gender Game. It's a giant board game that helps to raise awareness among children, young adults, and even adults ourselves towards gender imbalances and stereotypes. This giant board game is divided into four sections: knowledge, work, power, and society. And she has questions adapted for all ages. It also teaches players the underlying scientific method that was used to collect the research data on which the game is based. Now, the reasons why the jury selected this award for this publication for the award: the care that went into the creation of the gender game and the direct interaction with the children and adolescents, together with the scientific evaluation behind it, makes it a particularly well-targeted and executed project on gender stereotypes. The project relies on the principle research by society for society and tackles gender stereotypes directly where it is needed most, in the youngest. So let's take a closer look at Carole's work.
Mein Name ist Carole Blond-Hanten und ich bin Soziologin am LISER, dem Luxembourg Institute of Socioeconomic Research. Und meine Forschung geht über den Sozialdialog und über die Gleichheit zwischen Frauen und Männern in der Gesellschaft. Ich freue mich immens, vom FNR einen Award zu kriegen für Outstanding Promotion of Science to Public, und zwar für den Gigi, ein Gesellschaftsspiel, wo es um Geschlechterstereotypen und Forschung geht, und die Projekte haben wir zusammen um Lisa mit einer ganz flotten Equipe ausgeschafft. Gigi, das steht für Gender Game. Das ist ein riesiges Brettspiel, wo Matchspieler und Matchspielerinnen Frauen über Geschlechterstereotype Gestalt kriegen, aber wo wir gucken, ob ihr Antworten mit den Resultaten von der Forschung übereinstimmen. Denn Gigi hat zwei Ziele. Einerseits geht es darum, ob die Ungleichheit zwischen Frauen und Männern in der Gesellschaft aufmerksam zu machen. Und andererseits wollen wir speziell junge Erkenner für Forschung und wissenschaftliche Methoden begeistern. Und das eben auf eine spielerische Art und Weise. Wir haben Frauen, die aus vier Bereichen kommen. Das Wissen, Arbeit, Macht und Gesellschaft. Und wir haben Frauen für Erwachsene, für Junker und für Kinder. Ein Beispiel von einer Kinderfrau ist, wen hilft die Kinder bei den Hausaufgaben daheim? Sind die statt Mammen oder sind die statt Pappen? Und das Resultat aus der Forschung ist, dass bei den Mammen 71% bei den Hausaufgaben helfen, bei den Pappen sind da 53%. Und das Resultat diskutieren wir dann mit den Kindern. Das Spiel existiert schon seit 2016 und allein im letzten Jahr haben wir ungefähr mit 500 Leuten gespielt, darunter meistens Kinder und Jugendliche, aber auch Erwachsene. Wir waren am Spiel an Maison Relais, an Jugendhäusern, am Science Festival, auf den Researchers Days und sogar auf der Litzebuer Buchs. Die grosse Majorität der Participanten fand das Spiel ganz flott, aber besonders für die Jungen ist der Echange und Diskussion mit den Forschern und Forscherinnen ganz wichtig. Und sie sehen auch, dass verschiedene Statistiken sie total überrascht haben. Etwas, was wir schon angefangen haben, ist, dass wir einen detaillierten Vorbau auszuschaffen, für den Impact vom Spiel zu müssen. Da fragen wir zum Beispiel, was möchte der Forscher oder eine Forscherin, und da kommen ganz flott Antworten raus.
Ein Forscher sucht Lösungen, ein Forscher stellt sich Fragen.
Il veut savoir des choses.
Sie machen Experimente zusammen.
Ein Forscher oder eine Forscherin muss zählen 1 bis 200. Sie machen auch Fragen.
Sie gucken Mikroben.
Forscher und Forscherinnen vom Lisa und vom List sind auch am Gangen, um einem neuen Forschungsprojekt zu schaffen. Wo es darum geht, den Gigi technologisch und wissenschaftlich auszubauen. Der Grand Public wird auch bei diesem Projekt ein großer Bestandteil sehen. Also, Forschung für die Leute, mit den Leuten.
Carole, massive congratulations on this award for your outstanding game, the GG game. Tell us more about the idea behind it. How did you come up with this idea?
Already in 2014, we had moderated a science cafe about gender stereotypes. And out of this experience, we wanted to create something bigger and also to share our research with a wider public. So a game is a wonderful tool because everybody wants to play. So children, teenagers, adults all want to play, and it's fantastic because while we are playing, we are learning about gender. So we play gender and we learn about gender.
And no doubt it's not in a vacuum that you created this. So if you have any word of thanks for anybody that you would like to, this is your moment of glory.
Okay, may I say them in Luxembourg?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Also wenn Gigi kommt und stohen an sich entwickeln, weil Hannen Drohnen ein fantastisches Kip um Lisa ganz viel Arbeit an Energie an die Projekte gestoppt wird. Das war der Benoit Blondin, das der Tefa an Maike, an Mirizan Berenger, Monique und Roland, und aber auch der Manuel und Julie, die am Kader von ihrem Stage volontär die Kip an die Projekte bereichert tun. der ganzen Gigi-Team wirklich ein großes Merci an Bravo und alle Guten. Und dann auch ein Merci an die Leute als Support-Service von Lisa und als Direktion, die uns alle unterstützt haben. Und natürlich wirklich ein ganz besonderes Merci an den FNR. Wir alle echt für den Volley Promoting Science to Public eine große Visibilität zu geben. Und dann für hier Unterstützung über all die Jahre, sie wird Researchers Day, Science Festival, Promoting Science to Public, für uns hier die Unterstützung geben zu holen und auch nach weiterhin als Material gute Rutschläge zur Seite stehen. Und natürlich heute Novel ganz besonders für uns Arbeit mit diesem schönen Preis zu belohnen. Von ganzem Herzen FNR, merci für das Unerkennung. Mit den Gigi also auch noch nicht darüber. Also mit Forscher und Forscherinnen vom List sind wir am Gang in eine Podium zu stellen, wo wir den Gigi als Social Experiment an der Wissenschaft ersetzen. Mit dieser innovativen Methodologie wollen wir neue Erkenntnisse an der Forschung über Gender-Stereotypen erstellen. Weil wir haben heute noch keine Gleichheit in unserer Gesellschaft. Sieht das an der Politik, an den Gehältern, an den Medien oder an unseren Unternehmen. Auch die Forschung selber ist ein Bereich, wo Männer und Frauen noch immer ungleich repräsentiert sind. Das gesagt, einerseits an den Studien, wo verschiedene Disziplinen mehr Jungen oder mehr Mädchen präsent sind, oder nur noch auf den Führungsposten, wo, also Führungsposten an der Forschung, wo auch noch immer ganz wenig Frauen sind. Für eine gendergerechte Gesellschaft muss man wirklich systematisch geschlechtsspezifisch Daten erheben und darauf forschen, für dass das Erkenntnisse durch können Mainstream durch ein Sozialmodell und als Gesellschaft auflesen. Merci.
Thank you so much, Carole. And can you tell us what was the most unusual finding from your results?
Oh, there were many interesting results. As it was explained in the video, we played the Gigi and we had a parallel project. We used the Gigi as a social experiment where we collected data. So we had a questionnaire for the children and the teenagers. And some of the answers are really like in the stereotypes. For example, who is chef d'entreprise? Is it more men or more women? And the answer was, it is more men, there are more men, but why? It's, and I said in Luxembourgish, that men are making sin. Oh, isn't this a stereotype we haven't got somewhere in our education? Because men are stronger, or this was the answer. So we found in the answers of the children, we found this type of answers, and these are very interesting and encourage us to continue on this topic.
And continue you do, because I believe you're pursuing your own PhD at the moment.
Yes, that's right.
Which is a wonderful example. I think it's a fantastic thing. And you are then a role model for other people who don't do it directly after university to start a PhD at a different point in life. How is that, working that with your work and family life?
Oh, it's very complicated, to be very honest. It's not complicated because of my family life. It's complicated because I have different roles in LISA. I'm president of the staff delegation. I have my projects, and I have my PhD. So yeah, it's complicated, but feasible.
But now you have your award to look at. So every time you're fading, you can look at the award and it'll pep you up. Congratulations again from all of us here this evening.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Enjoy the rest of the night with your beautiful daughter. And I think I saw a cat there as well. Now moving on to the second awardee for the outstanding promotion of science to the public. We have a team, and they're going to be demonstrated by things we will have all seen around the city. There's a few remaining now. It's about mind the brain. Now, Sabine Schmitz is going to represent the team. Reasons why the jury selected this award, reasons why the jury selected them is because the project was able to make science a colourful part of Luxembourg City whilst providing relevant information about the underlying research and raising funds to support brain research at the same time. So let's take a look at this very colourful and innovative award.
My name is Sophie, and I'm part of a team of communicators and fundraisers at the LCSP, the Luxembourg Centre for Systems Biomedicine at the University of Luxembourg. Together, we received the FNR Award for Outstanding Promotion of Science to the Public for the art exhibition Mind the Brain, which is one of the many activities of the past 10 years to bring our research closer to the people. Mind the Brain was an art exhibition that we organized for the 10th anniversary of the LCSB in 2019. It consisted of 10 giant brain sculptures, each painted by a renowned Luxembourgish artist, that were displayed at prominent locations in the heart of Luxembourg City.
The main research focus of the SSB is neurodegenerative diseases, so diseases that affect the brain. With this unusual combination of art and science, we could reach many people and raise awareness for this type of research.
Each sculpture represented one of the scientific areas of the LCSB. For example, on Joel Rollinger's brain, which represents Alzheimer's disease, there were several human faces painted on to represent the fading memories that somebody with Alzheimer's disease experiences. Or on Eric Mangan's brain, it has very flashy colors to represent the electrical bursts that can happen in the brain of a patient with epilepsy.
Mind the Brain has been our biggest project of the past 10 years. Besides the heavy logistics of transporting and installing the brains, the project required a lot of different skills and team effort. The entire communication material, such as the flyers, the website, the advertising banners, the invitations, they were all created in-house, together with the visual identity of Mind the Brain.
Together with our researchers, we produced the scientific content that was easy to understand, so that at each sculpture, the visitor could learn about the research areas of the SSB. So besides raising awareness for our research, we also wanted to raise money to help funding the research. So the 10 sculptures were sold and they're also partially publicly displayed. Half of the funds went to the artist and the other half to a research project on Parkinson's disease.
Science outreach has been very important for the LCSB since its beginning. We like to attract attention through unusual events like Mind the Brain or the Pillow Fight, an event to raise awareness for the fight that Parkinson's patients go through. We want our research to be there for the people, not least because its ultimate goal is to help people live better lives.
Sabine, on behalf of your team, congratulations for this award. It was such a fantastic, I mean, when I walked through the city and I saw these big brains, nobody could miss them. First of all, tell us about your team and who would you like to thank?
Yeah, thank you very much. We're very honored to receive this award tonight, of course, in a different setting than what we had hoped for. So I speak now on behalf of the entire team. And first, I would like to thank the FNR for giving us this award, but also for putting such an emphasis on science communication. Then I would like to thank the LCSB and university leadership, who we reached out to with an idea that might have sounded a bit crazy at first and who had trust in us and supported us to bring Mind the Brain to life.
Similarly, at the City of Luxembourg, the events team, who has been very supportive and who believed in this idea and has gone through us through the entire process of bringing this exposition into the city so that everybody could see it. Then there are countless colleagues at the university who helped with one in one way or another, from scientific teams, administrative teams, and without their help, this project would have not been a reality. And as you've seen, the aim of the project was also to support research through it. So I would like to thank our supporters and buyers who helped us achieve this, and whose support now fuels research into the early stages of Parkinson's disease. But now, of course, I come to the people who did the majority of the work. On the one hand, a big, big thanks to the artists that collaborated with us. And I would like to take the chance to name them here individually. So this was Monique Becker, Thomas Isa, Daniel Lloyd, Marc Pierre, Stick, Raphael Gint, Frank Jones, Erik Mangen, Joel Rollinger, and Alain Welter. So through their color, they brought the color and creativity to this project to make our science visible. And it was really amazing to see how much they wanted to support our research through their art, and then how they approached the challenge to create these beautiful sculptures. And then, of course, in the end, seeing them at the different locations in the city, that has simply been priceless. We're very honored to have been working with you. And then last but not least, of course, to the amazing team I'm very proud to share this award with, Sophie Wagner, Ruxandra Soare, Lucy Debroux, Lisa Smits, and Philip Lamesch. Really, your creativity and dedication and teamwork brought this vision to life, that we wanted to celebrate LCSB's birthday and share our research with the people. And I'm, of course, very sad we can't be together on stage today, but I hope we can celebrate soon together again. And I'm very lucky to have a team like you, and I hope we do many great projects together in the future.
Well, congratulations to you and your team once more. It was a beautiful project. Really, nobody in the city could miss it. And now, of course, we still have a few remaining, and a few have gone to private buyers. And also, it raised money for the research. And I believe it really helped also just celebrate the LCSB on its 10th anniversary. But you had to convince your director.
Well, at first, we were discussing about celebrating LCSB's birthday or not, and he was at first a bit reluctant, and we had a few discussions until we better understood each other, because it was not about not celebrating LCSB's birthday per se, but not celebrating it in a classical way with only a selected few people that were invited and a glass of Cremant and a few speeches. The purpose should really be to bring LCSB's research to the people and to celebrate together and to really show what we do, because this is at the core of the LCSB, and this is what we have done throughout the decade. And so this kind of, once we have understood that stimulated us to think out of the box on how we could celebrate it differently, and through a few brainstormings, first a cup of coffee with my colleague Philip Lamesch, who's also an artist himself, and then additional brainstormings with my team, this idea was born. And we then pitched it to people at the LCSB, at the university. And when you then see the sparkle in people's eyes when you pitch the idea, you know you're on the right track. And so we're pursuing this and are very happy with the result.
And then you interviewed Luxembourg and said, can we just pop 10 large brains into the city? And they said yes.
In a way, yes. The events team in Luxembourg knew us already. We had done the pillow fight 2 years prior to that. So it's not the first a bit out of the box idea that we pitched. And we pitched a few different ideas, and this is the one we retained together. And so we're very grateful to have been working with them, and also that they put the trust in us, because this is obviously not a project we do on a daily basis.
You're building a reputation for extraordinary, innovative science communication, you and your team. Mark, turning to you, it's something that you've really promoted within the FNR Awards ceremony tonight. It's this interaction with the public, the science communication element. Why is that important to FNR?
Well, several answers to that. I think it's we also do quite substantially do our own share of public engagement with websites like science.lu, which has been very heavily used, especially also to learn about COVID and all these things. We also fund specific activities. I think it's science. Our philosophy is really science, and I think we have had a wonderful sample tonight. Science should be in the center of society. So this image of an ivory tower where you have weird people doing things that no one else understands, and I think that's an image of the past. We really want to see science as embedded within the society, and therefore it's important that we communicate. And also that we get the public into it, and really what we've seen tonight, this project where we get artists were involved. We've seen previous projects where research projects where industry was ArcelorMittal was involved. We've seen projects where the educational system was involved. I think that's exactly what science should be. It should be we should do our science, which can be fundamental, but I think. It should reach out to all areas of society, and that's I think what this division division for science in society that we have and that we want to support.
Well, Sabine, I think you and your team demonstrate that web of science in the centre spreading out towards the public so very well. Congratulations once more to you and your team.
Congratulations.
Well, that ends the awards part of this evening. Thank you so much for joining us, for sharing this evening with us. Thank you too to Romain for stepping in right at the last minute in place of Minister Maisch. How has it been for you this evening? What have you learned from this science evening?
Again, as Mark already said, how this research ecosystem has grown into something that is really in society, that is linked to society. Mark said this is absolutely no ivory tower. I think we saw that we are really also, we have a very broad scope. And what I already said in the introduction, you really see, and we had again examples here, that dealing also with our local specificities is something that can make us known worldwide, and that we do excellent research. We are on the map, and we contribute globally, and we contribute nationally by the results that research produces. And I think the whole endeavor of doing science, and you see it today, is also a lot of fun. I think one thing, and I hope it was as entertaining for the public as it was here, to sit here, to see these fantastic things that are done. And I hope also that we saw a lot of people having their kids here, and I hope that some kids will watch this FNR Awards ceremony and just get the taste of it and say, wow, this is something that I want to do. And I'm convinced that also by giving these examples, we will not have any problems to find also future scientists, because it's just amazing. It's just fun to do science.
Well, actually, you've touched on something. I spoke with Laurent Pfister, one of the awardees this evening. And like many scientists, they go into schools, they talk to the school children, and he always encourages them to have intense curiosity. And he talks about this word in English, believe. And he said in the middle of the word believe is lie. So you have to make sure that you question. And it's lovely to have that integration from the scientists into the school life as well. Mark, any standout points this evening for you?
Well, I think what we also saw are people, researchers, scientists with a lot of dedication. I think it needs a lot of dedication. They're all, I would say, 24 hours a day scientists, and I think the support from family is extremely important. It is sometimes a lonely a lonely task as well. I think we discussed it yesterday. As scientists, we're on the limit, on the frontier of the unknown. I always say 80% of our thoughts and of our hypotheses turn out to be wrong. It takes time. It takes, we've seen one project, 9 years to collect data. It takes dedication, and that we've seen a lot tonight. But I think there is the reward at the end as well. So I'm extremely pleased what we've seen. It's also so international. We've seen Luxembourg research embedded in this international community. So I'm very, very proud that we could contribute a little bit to making this happen.
And that international flair is something that's completely embedded within Luxembourg society, and you must see this all the time on a political, ministerial level, and how policies are formed and research strategies and pillars are made. What is it that you think about? You said you had earlier this year those pillars put in place. But when you're thinking about Luxembourg, geographically, it's not huge. It's not a large population. A lot of it is international. How do you think about making Luxembourg stand out from that, and in this particular field, higher research field?
Well, I think that specifically Luxembourg has its size, also being a small country, is I think for research a real advantage, because we are a kind of living laboratory. We can show to the world how also new technologies, innovations function at the scale of a country, because we are more flexible in implementing things. And I think also, and I think Luxembourg is also a role model for its variety, diversity. I think diversity is really something that is valued in Luxembourg. We've seen this multilingualism. I think especially in these times where we have also on the global scales movements that go into another direction, Luxembourg also stands out by saying, look at us, diversity, international outlook is something that is rewarding and is a way we should go forward. And I think a lot of people from the outside look at us in a very positive way. And as I said, especially in these times where we know that at the global scales, we also have the counterexamples.
Well, we wish you and your team the very best of luck at the moment. It's not easy times. I'm pretty sure you're working very, very hard indeed. Thank you, Mark, and your team for putting on this awards ceremony. As you said, at least 80% of scientific research is knocking your head against a wall, feeling rather lonely and morose at times when things don't work well. But we've seen things tonight which have worked superbly well, albeit through time, through international players and through immense teamwork. To all of the awards, once more, massive congratulations to all of our viewers, new viewers who perhaps don't know so much about science. We really hope that you've enjoyed tonight's show and that you stick with us and the ideas of science behind that. Just a few other thank yous to say. I must say, on behalf of you, Mark, for your fantastic team, Didier Goossens and Sonia Ramos and the whole FNR team, because without them, tonight wouldn't look like this. And we have had many steps to come to this very intimate setting, which I have personally very much enjoyed, and it's been a great privilege to be a part of that tonight. And of course, the production values are of such high quality. That's all down to Lemon for the core production for this whole setting. Thank you to them and their immense team as well behind the scenes. But most especially, once more, to end the evening, we give our great thanks and our thoughts tonight to the awardees. Have a wonderful evening.